Ho, ho, ho!
Hello, nice to see you again.
Yes, and welcome to Arduino EDUvision Holiday Special.
Nice. We're very excited to show everything we prepared today.
Yes, and I can see already a lot of people joining.
Nice. Remember that we want to know where you're from, what you're doing, what's your name. So everything please share on the chat because we want to know you. So hi everyone that is joining now. Don't forget to tell where are you from.
Exactly. And if this is your first EDUvision.
Yeah. But this is very special because this is from Nepal, a holiday special episode.
Yes.
So nice.
But we ask, you might have noticed if you've watched EDUvision before, if you follow our Facebook or Instagram channel, we asked what would you like to see during the coming seasons and new episodes that we have. And a lot of you mentioned that you would like to see a lot of Arduino projects, Arduino tutorials, and what you can
Chicago.
Do with Arduino. And today we actually will listen to you, and we have a lot of cool projects, holiday projects from our community.
Yes.
And hopefully you get some inspiration what you can do during if you have a vacation coming, for example. We will present some step-by-step tutorials that you can follow. You can create your own holiday mood
projects. Yeah, that's so nice. Look, we have people from Indonesia, the US, Amsterdam, South Africa, Lithuania, Italy, Denmark, Nepal, Mexico. Nice. Thank you all for joining. But also today, we have two amazing guests. They're from Canada, Benjamin Douek and Alexander Somma. They're really cool. They are innovators, entrepreneurs, and they're very passionate about learning and teaching. So they're going to share with us their initiatives and what have been doing with their students. So stay tuned.
Yes. And also we have a special message from the Arduino product owners.
Ooh.
And some live project. You're gonna hear something from Roxana again.
Oh my goodness. Let's see how that goes.
we can show you. I don't know, all of you who've been following Arduino, you found your way here. But now, if you don't have your own advent calendar, for example, you can go to arduino.cc.
Exactly.
And there's a open your, should I share my screen actually? Should I show?
Yeah, let's watch that.
Yeah, I can show a clip of it or sneak peek.
Yeah, it's really cool. So you just go every day, like you follow the link, Arduino.cc, Arduino Liday. Yeah,
yes,
that one.
So every day here, we're gonna have a new surprise for you. There are a lot of cool stuff, and it's until the 29th, as you can see. So, or 30th actually, 31st. I saw the first, I was just looking at the 29th. It's until the end of the month.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know how many days there's in. No, but then you can see, for example, the first one here. So we have the sensor kit. So there's a new kit that was released on the 1st of December, if you didn't know, for example. So if you haven't opened this, go and check it out. You can find it from our homepage on arduino.cc.
Yeah, exactly. Something new every day. So that's really cool. So many people joining. Thank you again for joining from Algeria, Myanmar, Thailand, Peru.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of new people.
Yeah, there is so cool.
Before.
Yeah, I think so. Myanmar, India. Thank you everyone for joining. So, but what if we start with our guest?
Yeah.
So as we mentioned, we're going to have, or we're having from Canada, Ben and Alex, experts in the field of electronics. Ben has a background in software and mechanical engineer, and Alex is a software and web developer. So, but they created an incubator called Robot in a Can, and now they're dedicated to create STEM educational material for teachers. And they want to help the next generation of coders and computer scientists through their learning platform. But why don't we take a look of the things that they have been doing so far, and then we bring them.
Yeah, we have a video clip from our guests.
Let's check that.
My name is Erica, and I'm 8 years old. We have paper with glitter, and we're gonna cut it out and put it on a photo.
So we signed my daughter up for an art class because she was looking for things to do. We wanted to keep her engaged. We're not taking part in too many things outside of the house right now that we're in isolation, and we're still looking for things to stimulate her and for entertainment.
Enseigner en ligne, ça permet aux enfants de faire leur art en privé. Donc, s'ils veulent faire quelque chose qui est un petit peu plus comme émotionnel à eux, ils n'ont pas besoin de le partager avec tout le monde dans la classe. Donc, ils peuvent le faire en privé et sont confortables, sont dans un environnement confortable à la maison.
It's extremely convenient, so we don't even have to leave the house. All the materials are here for the entire session for art. And it's 1 hour where she's very, very engaged. So yes, absolutely, it's an affordable option for something to do.
Souvent, comme artiste, tu te mets dans une bulle une fois que tu as commencé. Tu peux rester dans cette bulle-là pendant 3-4 heures. Là. Donc, ça leur permet de continuer à la maison sans le prof. Garder cette option-là, puis avoir des personnes qui vont travailler seulement en ligne, ça devrait être une option partout.
There are so many benefits, especially we save time as well. And we're able to use technology and meet people from all over the place, so we don't even have to stay extremely local. So these opportunities are going to be available for a broader reach. So I think it's an excellent idea that is going to be here to stay.
I would like to continue doing art classes and maybe do a different one too.
Nice. Okay.
Beautiful.
Why don't bring yes.
Hey everybody.
Hello.
Hello. So
Welcome.
It's
Thank
like
you for having us.
Ben.
So I'm Ben.
And Alex. How are you guys?
Awesome.
Good, thanks.
Thank you for joining. And welcome to EDUvision.
It's really our pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much. So why don't we start you by telling us how did you start with this initiative of like teaching youngsters how to code and electronics?
So this is actually, it's a project that we started a few years ago. And I think I was inspired to start this because I felt very fortunate. When I was in grade 3, I started programming with an incredible teacher. And she was just fantastic, you know, showing us things. And I really, really took to coding. And also, Alex and I actually both have some learning disabilities too. And this really, coding was something that I think we both really felt comfortable with when we were younger. And when I went on to university, I noticed that a lot of people were having a lot of difficulty with their coding classes, so much so that one of our classes had a 70% failure rate, which is really, yeah, a lot. So I kind of went around and started asking people, you know, if they had done any coding before coming to university, and many of them said no. So this made me realize that there was a large need to start people coding even younger, and this led us to start the project and to try to get more young people involved in coding and electronics as well.
Nice. And then also, Alex, you were also involved before in software development, or right? And then yes. You move also to STEAM. So yes. How was that?
So what happened was, I've been dealing with software development since the early 2000s. And when Etsy was getting off the ground, I actually joined their team. I was the fifth developer there. And Make Magazine and also actually Hackaday used to rent space from Etsy. So I was based here in Montreal, and I would be going down to New York for a week out of every month and doing fun development, both remotely. I was already doing remote work then, but I would end up talking with Bree Pettis and Phil, and I was getting into the maker culture, and I was going to Resistor, NYC Resistor, when it was just getting off the ground. And when I stepped away from Etsy, I realized that what my passion was, my passion wasn't just the coding, but it was actually that more collaborative, creative aspect of it. So as I stepped away, I started to focus more on consulting in the edtech world. And I also got started with FooLab here in Montreal. So for a while I was the president of FooLab, and my whole focus was really focusing on working with schools and developing curriculum and developing code for them. Okay. And then what happened was, people at the study, one of my clients, met Ben, and they thought that the two of us had to meet.
So we met and we just started talking, and we couldn't stop talking. So we decided to partner up on this project. I was working with the education technology department at Concordia, and they'd invited me to the Maker Faire. So I was presenting my robots. I had just done an amazing project actually in Mexico, where we worked with 1,000 students, and we did this incredible ideathon. So students had 4 hours to come up with an idea, make a business plan, and build a prototype, learning to code. And they were using the robot in a CAN platform. So I came back quickly from that. I was doing the Maker Faire and showing off the robots. And that's when the study saw it. And they're an incredible school with a really, really great, very strong STEM program. And they do STEAM programming. And so they bought a few robots, and I went to go deliver. And when I did, that's when they suggested that Alex and I should meet. And we met at FooLab, which is the hackerspace. And from there, we've been working on the project since.
Nice.
Okay. And now you've been working a lot with this kind of chance for students to learn also remotely, to have the tool, like we are here now, we're all in different places, and being able to have this conversation. And everyone who's watching this, if you have any questions for our guests, please use the chat on YouTube and Facebook if you have anything you would like to ask from these guys. But also, you've been running some really successful hybrid classes at the moment. So can you tell us about the challenges and strategies that you have for these hybrid or remote learning?
I think that it's best if Ben answers this, because he's completely in a hybrid environment. He's having to teach online at the exact same time as he's remote. My students are in much more akin to this environment, but Ben actually has it so that there's screens that represent students in the classes that he's in, and he has real students there. So why don't you lead with this?
Sure, yeah. So, I mean, it's been a really interesting transition, right? So all the schools closed in March, and we transitioned to fully online, and Alex and I worked very hard on that. But lately, this semester, I'm teaching hybrid. So I have a class full of students, and in sometimes the back of the class, sometimes the front of the class, I have an iPad with, you know, 4 or 5 students there that are at home. And you have to try to manage, you know, meeting the needs of the students that are physically in the class, and not forgetting that there are, you know, sometimes 4 or 5 students all in like on an iPad in the back. So it's really important, I guess. So some of the strategies that I've been employing to really engage everybody, if this is, you know, something that maybe some of you teachers also are experiencing. So first of all, I think it's really important that, you know, that they be able to see the classroom like the other students. So to face them, you know, obviously towards the board so that they could see everything, but also in such a way that, you know, their questions can be heard. So make sure their volume is all the way up. And ideally, if possible, have a projector, which is something with some of our clients that we've done some, you know, education consulting for. We've set up projectors so that they're not just tiny, tiny on an iPad and you forget about them. They're larger and you can see them on the screen in the back, either a TV or a projector. Yeah, Alex.
So an example of that that we've set up with actually our partner, Centre Préville, that you saw the video of the space that we did that was the online aspect. Maybe we could get you a video of it, but we also have actually dance studios now that are hybrid. So we have it that there's massive projector, just like you would normally have the mirrors. You have a projected space so that people, when they're at home and can't be there, they're able to participate and be seen by the instructor. And she's then able to really address the form that they're having. So that projector makes such a big difference. As big as possible is really what it comes down to. While I'm working from home, I actually have it so that I went and got a secondhand 4K TV, and I use that as my monitor for when I'm in conferences. So I have you folks pretty well life-size right now. And if anyone can do that, find a projector or get a TV just for when you're doing that live interaction to make it so that it really feels like you're there with the people. It makes it so much more enjoyable for every participant because there's little emotions that are hidden when it's too small.
Absolutely. And it's hard to tell when people are disengaged, right? Because sometimes you might find, especially when you're grading, you know, if you're doing it for school, you might find all of a sudden that, you know, the people online seem to be really getting it until the quiz comes around. And you notice, oh, maybe some of our online learners haven't been paying as much attention as they seem to. So that's another important thing, to have some quizzes or ways that they can actually engage. Because during lecture, it's much easier to, I think, to deal with students who are physically there. Another thing that we've really done a lot of is building kits and finding ways to make sure that everybody at home has the same materials as the people in class so that they don't feel left out. And this leads to other interesting issues, right? We've been building a lot of things. So like lately, we made some headphones and built our own speakers by winding our own electromagnets and making our own speakers from scratch using construction paper. And that was a very cool project. But of course, making sure our learners online are winding up the thin wire properly without getting it tangled in knots and making sure that they're following the steps properly. So, and of course, as a teacher, you might find that you're in high demand, you know? You know, come over here. I need your help. And your attention is very divided, right? So you got to make sure you're giving the attention to the people online too. And what I found really helps. So I have a rule in my classroom that's always ask three before you ask me. And that's something I inherited from that teacher I had in grade three. And it really encourages peer learning, peer-to-peer learning. So students can ask other students in the class. And if three students in the class still don't have the answer to the question, then they can come to ask me or the teacher. And the same applies online. So encourage the students online, on the iPad, on the projector, to actually ask other students in the class for help. And this really frees you up to respond to the students who need the most help. And if a student online has a very simple problem, you can have another student help them solve it. And of course, if you choose a student who's a bit ahead, they feel really special, you know, being put in kind of a teacher role and teaching the students online. And of course, you know, the students really miss each other, right? So just having them see each other and talk to each other is such a great opportunity for them. So these are some things that I really recommend, especially if you're in a hybrid environment where you have students physically in the classroom and some students who can't join and are staying online.
As you progress to being more online, because hybrid's a sliding scale, of course, so I suggest the use of breakout rooms and having it so that you continue that ask three before me, but you have it so that you have the students group into smaller little pods and have it so that you don't have more than four in one of the breakout rooms. And we needed this so much when we were in the purely online state that we went and built that platform that was actually then used by Préville that had integrated breakout rooms, and it has it so that our education platform with our curriculum is there. And having it that you have something that really allows the students to have ease of getting around makes a huge, huge difference. So the students that are online, you have to not like focus on them completely, but you have to make sure that they are engaged and that they aren't overwhelmed with the online aspect. So that's what, from somebody who's dealing more with the online than the in-person aspect of hybrid, I have to add to that.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you. So, there are a lot of free tips for teachers who are now hybrid teaching, or even if you have the lockdown, for example, now, and you have a remote teaching, the breakout rooms, for example, is a really good tip.
Right, and one more thing just to add, if you're lucky and you have an assistant or a student teacher with you, right, when students have technical difficulties, this might be something that other teachers are experiencing, right? Someone has difficulty with their microphone, or there's one dialogue in the online learning setup. There, one dialogue kind of dominates the entire conversation because it's hard to have small side conversations. So we've set up a breakout room for tech support and have either a tech support person for the entire program or the entire school there always to help out. Or at the very least, you can ask a student teacher to step out into a breakout room to solve those problems before rejoining. And we found that made our classes run so much smoother.
Yeah, nice. So what are your future plans with all of this material and platforms that you have built?
What is our future plan?
Yeah, what is next?
There's two major things. One, we just recently got our latest and greatest eBrain developed. So up until recently, our robots worked purely over Wi-Fi, or if you were an expert hacker, you could use an FTDI cable. But we recently added USB. So you have battery bank options, or you have USB, or you have also USB battery bank options to keep things really like flexible. So we came out with that, and we're doing a major update to our education platform for delivering code and engaging with students. And then that goes hand in hand with something that we're not quite ready to show yet, but we're using at Prayville and a few other institutions are using, and that's our online education real-time platform.
So if you're not familiar too, just a little bit of background. So our system is a drag and drop programming system. So if you've ever heard of Scratch or Snap or something like that, our system is based on Snap. So it's drag and drop programming, but it's also based on the Arduino platform. So a lot of our inspiration came from the Arduino platform. Arduino projects are things I've been following and are so close to my heart since the beginning, since I was like, I guess around 15. I've been looking at that kind of stuff and following Arduino projects very closely on sites like Instructables and places like that. And so our system is built on easy drag and drop. So you put in these blocks in order, right, to make your projects, although you can also program it with the Arduino IDE using the USB cable and program it in Arduino C just like an Arduino. But it's also a Wi-Fi kit. So there's a Wi-Fi transmitter on the kit. So all of your code gets sent to the chip via Wi-Fi, and you can build some robots. There's a stepper motor controller, so you can control two motors with a high degree of accuracy, and that lets us build our two motors, two servos, so up to four motors, but two stepper motors, two servo motors, and you can build all kinds of little robots with that. As you can see in the background there, in Alex's background, you can see one of our cardboard robots. So our robots are made of cardboard, and you fold them up. There's blue wheels. And I believe Alex's son made that robot. So our robots are made of cardboard, and all of our projects that we try to make out of low-cost and recyclable materials. And we're also based in Quebec. I saw somebody in the chat saying they're from a BTB. Shout out. So we're also based in Quebec, and we're working on these projects. And like Alex is saying, we're working on putting up a online platform for teachers to see a lot of the projects. Some of the projects require the kit, some are just code related. And we're trying to make lots of resources for teachers so that people around the world can have access to some really top quality programming lessons that they can deliver with their students and that are very accessible, low cost, sometimes no cost, yeah. right? Just having a computer or something to teach with, of course. But to make this, it's really powerful stuff, obviously, right?
Yeah. And if people want to know more about this, they can visit your site that we have on the screen. Is it right? The robotinacan.com. Yes. So whoever wants to know more about this, yes.
Hello exactly. to know.
Yeah, I might be near it. I'm not sure.
Read on it.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you so much, guys, for joining. Very interesting tips for everyone. Thank you so much for sharing and keep doing a great job.
Thank you so much for having us. And yeah, it's been a real pleasure and
thank you.
An honor to be here with
Thank
some
you for
of
joining. And hopefully thank see you. You in future seasons.
Exactly. Yeah. See you soon.
Thank you. Take Bye. Care.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you to Ben and Alex.
Yes, and you can learn more about their work or read the interview from our remote learning site or actually our new education site that has nice. The section for remote learning. So arduino.cc/education/remote learning.
Yep.
I can show it quickly. So
brand new.
Yes. So we have on our education side, you can find all the solutions for middle school, high school, university. We have a section for certification, own section for EDUvision.
Nice.
And then for the remote learning, where you can find the articles like before. And here we have the article, an interview with Alexander Somma and Ben Douek. If you
exactly.
want to know more about them.
Nice.
And here you can also see the tutorials.
Exactly.
Yes.
Nice. So what if we take a look at some holiday projects we have prepared from people from the Arduino community for the holidays? So
yes.
you will see on the link, you will see on the chat the link so you can see the full video because these are just clips. So let's take a look.
Noche de paz, noche de amor, todos acá, por favor. Mamá y hijo con ande paz, disfrutando su noche de paz. Sueña un sueño imposible, sueña un sueño imposible.
Nice project.
They were really
we're full
nice.
Of lights. Yeah.
And if you want to, a lot of the videos also include tutorial how to create the same project. So we have all the links for the videos in our chat in Facebook and YouTube, so you can build your own projects.
Yeah. So now what if we take a look to the first video of the one of our product owners, Ernesto. Let's see what he prepared.
Hi, my name is Ernesto, and I am the product owner of the engineering kit. I just want to wish you happy holidays, and let us know in the comment section if you have the time to play with the kit or do any other projects with Arduino. Felices fiestas.
Thank you, Ernesto. And like Ernesto said, if you have used, for example, the Arduino engineering kit, or if you have used any other educational kits that we have, or Arduino board and other components, we would like to know, what do you build with them? Did you create your own Christmas project? If you did, you can, and if you have it in social media, for example, you can of course share the link with others.
Yeah. But
then you can also comment.
You can share. Yes, that would be cool. What else we have?
Yes, we have also from another product owner, we have actually a clip what you can do with the Arduino Science Kit Physics Lab. Yeah, so our owner, Valentina Kinichi, she's also the product owner of the Arduino Science Journal app that we can explain a bit after the clip.
Hi, I'm Valentina Kinnici, and today we're going to experiment together using an Arduino 33 BLE-Sense board as well as the Arduino Science Journal app. And the sensors that we picked up is the color temperature sensor. So, color temperature is a characteristic of visible light, indicates light in a range going from red to orange to yellow to white to bluish white. Lower cool temperatures between 2700 and 3000 K are called warm colors, and they're generally yellowish. Color temperature is conventionally expressed in kelvins using the K symbol. Color temperature over 5000 K are called cool colors, bluish. In this context, it's also used as an analogy to radiated heat flux of the traditional incandescent lighting rather than actual temperature. So, although it does not make sense to speak of the color temperature of a green or a red light, we decided that for the sake of Christmas, we would measure the color temperature of the Christmas lights. We really hope that you enjoyed this short video. Happy holidays, everyone, from the Arduino Education and the Arduino Science Journal team. Thank you.
Thank you, Valentina.
Thank you. Nice project. So actually, they can go online, right, and search for Arduino Science Journal. You can download it on your phone, available for Android and iOS, and it's really cool.
Yes, and it's all free. You can download the app mm-hmm. right away if you don't have it yet. You find it from your store, and then you can see the different experiments that you can do with the Arduino board and with the app. You can find it free from our site.
Exactly. And talking about the science kit, what we have?
We have a discount. So for all the little scientists out there, if you have a little scientist at home that you would like to experiment, the Science Kit Physics Lab, you don't have to code at all. So it's more just experimenting your home, doing different kinds of science experiments. And now we have 25% discount until Friday, midnight Central European time.
Yeah, so try it. You can also search for Science Kit and take a look.
Yes.
Nice.
Definitely. I can recommend. It's really fun.
Yeah. No coding.
Yes.
So
it's easy.
We have another tutorial, right?
Yeah. Also, it's also a kind of simple or for beginners, whoever who has the, if you remember the Starter Kit tutorials that we did this summer, and we had a 15 tutorials. We have one more now. So Woo-hoo. From the remote learning side, or the arduino.cc/education/remote-learning, mm-hmm. you can see there's this is a it's the first one, the first tutorial. When you enter this page, you can see the holiday lights.
Nice.
So, yeah,
Yeah, it's really cool because the thing is, like, you be creative and create like the cardboard, like Melissa showed. You can have different shapes or use the light differently. But that's a really easy tutorial to follow and start playing with lights.
Definitely. And if you have the starter kit, you don't have to, of course, you don't have to do a holiday project. It can be whatever. Like in the video, yeah. I also mentioned that you could do, for example, if you want to add the servo motor or the DC motor, you can make a ballerina that spins around on one leg and has different lights on her dress, or you could do whatever. So it doesn't have to be a holiday project. It can be a whatever kind of project, yeah, with the lights.
Just play with the ladies.
Definitely.
But then what if we take a look to another project? This honors the ugly sweater tradition for the holidays. And this is a video tutorial from David Quartier, is one of our co-founders. So he built a really nice, ugly LED sweater. So this was for the Hour of Code tutorial. So let's take a look.
I don't know if you're familiar with the tradition of ugly sweaters, but there's a whole bunch of them on the internet. There's all sorts of pictures with them, like reindeer, Santa Claus. There's like the appropriate ones and the less appropriate ones. Anyway, in the spirit of the Hour of Code, I have decided to make my own ugly sweater. And it's going to be interactive. It's going to have an Arduino, Nano Every, a button, and a ring of LEDs that I'm going to show you right now. So the parts that I have for me today, I will be using is a sweater, this blue sweater. Is ugly by itself. I've made a nice thing to decorate it. It's very pixelated, and the idea is that it will look good when I take a selfie. So it's going to be a selfie ugly sweater. And there is, of course, an Arduino Nano Every, so you can see there. Oh, let's move the camera. An LED ring, or multiple LED rings, some thread and some needles, because I need to stitch this whole thing onto my sweater, and a push button to change mode. So, sorry for that. Thing is, like, making this thing here obviously takes more than 1 hour because I made it really large. So let me see, let me show you how I made it.
So it's very long tutorial, but you will see on the chat the link. And this is how it looks. So this is the ugly sweater working now, and this is the Nano Every board. And every time you press here, the lights change the mode. So I'm going to change here, and now it's like a circular. So you press, and it changes. So it's really cool. Nice. So all the instructions are there. So there's no excuse to grab an ugly sweater and make it cool for the holidays.
Yeah, nice. Like Andy wrote, everybody wears them, so everybody wears one, so...
Yeah, exactly.
Now you can create your unique one following the tutorial that David has. So you can create this exact same one if you want to.
Yes, so it's really cool. Nice.
And then we have another season's greetings from our product owner of the student kit.
Nice.
Hi everyone, I'm Claudio and I'm the product owner of the Arduino Student Kit. It has been a really weird year, but I wanted to tell you that it has made me really happy to see students building their amazing projects and being able to keep learning and continue learning and tinkering and crafting and experimenting from home or from their classroom this year. And I just want to wish you relaxing holidays and Happy New Year to you all.
Thank you.
Thank you to Claudio.
There was a comment also that something that like that would look cool on a phone case. Definitely. Good idea.
Yeah, exactly.
If you try that, share the
Let us know.
Yeah. I want to see that.
Yeah, that's cool.
But Rox, you used the student kit and created something.
Yes. So on the student kit, you have all the components to build projects, and I built this. This is the keyboard, the musical keyboard. So, and actually you can play music. So let me change my camera so you can see it in action. So let's take a look.
So you get to guess again.
Look, I invited Santa to watch my concert. So let's see. So, but this is really cool because this keyboard can play a full octave. So you have four notes, and each note or each key has two notes, one high and one low. And also this is based on the ABC notation. If you're more used to the syllable system, the do, re, mi, fa, you can put here, like me, on the keys, the equivalent for A, B, C, D to do, re, mi. So, okay, I hope you can listen this. Can you listen?
Yes,
so you can try to guess what I'm going to attempt to play. So let's see if I can do it in one attempt. So. Something like that. Ta-da!
Amazing.
Woo! It wasn't that bad this time.
If you ever quit at Arduino, you should start like a career as a musician.
I should start.
It was nice.
Nice. So you can build yours and try. So that would be really, really cool.
Definitely. And this one, this project was created with the components that come with the student kit. And there is a lesson in the student kit where you learn to create your own keyboard.
Exactly. So, and you can play whatever song, just look for the keys and then you can start playing. It's really nice. You can adjust the frequencies. You can do many, many things.
Great. It was perfect.
Nice.
And remember the discount code for the Science Kit Physics Lab. So it's valid until Friday, midnight, Central European time.
Exactly.
So let it snow, everything with capital, all together.
Let it snow. Let it
snow. And you get 25% discount.
Yeah. Don't forget to build some projects yourself and share that on our social media. It will be so cool to see what you're doing.
Yeah, now many people may have vacation, a few weeks, 1 week, some days off, so it can be fun to experiment at home with your family.
Exactly. It's a really good way to do cool stuff.
Yes.
Nice.
That's it for today. Thank you all for joining. If you have any ideas what you would like to see next year, let us know. You can use the contact form on our arduino.cc/education, or you can use our social media channels. You can comment on this video, for example, YouTube, Facebook. You can use the comment section. So we would really like to know.
Yes. Thank you all for joining and hope to see you soon on the season number 3.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Happy Take holidays. Care. Happy New Year.
Take care. See you.
Bye.
Bye.